Good morning, all of you. In the past few classes, we have been discussing English sounds, and we started with defining and differentiating between phonetics and phonology. Then we also discussed the problems that we find in English writing system. We have also discussed various places of articulations. We have discussed the manner of articulations, voice and voicing. And now we have a fair idea of English consonant sounds, that how they are pronounced and why stop is called stop or a fricative is called fricative. So there is some rationale. There is some logic behind naming the manner of articulation in a particular way. So that we have already seen, and now we will proceed further. And there is one term, it's a jargon in phonetics and phonology, that is a phoneme. We will start with that. So what is a phoneme? Now the definition says, the minimal meaningful sound unit of a language, which occurs in contrast with other sounds in a language. So two information this definition provides us. First is, phoneme is a minimal meaningful sound unit. So two things, minimal and meaningful. Now you may raise a question that what is the meaning of pa? But now, since you have studied that pa is a plosive sound or stop, pa is bilabial, pa is voiceless, so now pa is meaningful for you. Previously, if you have not studied phonetics and phonology, then someone says, what is the meaning of pa? Then you will say, I don't know what is the meaning of pa. It is some sound, but it has no meaning. If someone says, what is the meaning of ta? Now you can very well say that th is an alveolar sound, and it's a voiceless sound. So this information you have. So now these sounds, these individual sound units, they are meaningful for you, and they are minimal. And why they are called minimal? Because what else can be less than a sound? For example, if I say p, and if I say this is the minimal, and if you cross questions, no, it's not minimal, then what is less than a sound? Nothing. There is silence is less than a sound. So we are not talking about silence, but we are talking about sound. So pa is a minimal meaningful sound unit of a language. Now we have used the term of a language. That means we know that there are different languages. We also know that in different languages we have this p sound. For example, pat is an English word, and the first sound is p, and pal is a Hindi word, and the initial sound is p. So this is how we can say that one individual sound unit is minimal and meaningful for us. At the same time, this minimal sound unit occurs in contrast with other sounds in a language. There are two examples. First example is sit. So when I say sit, you can clearly understand that I am uttering an English word, sit. At the same time, at sound level, you know that I am uttering three sounds, sa, e, t. And when I say sa, e, t very quickly, then it becomes sit. Now, contrast. Contrast means in opposition. So sa, the first sound in sit, e, the second sound in sit, and t, the third sound in sit. If I raise a question, do you feel that these sounds are same? these sounds are similar, you will say no, these sounds are different. And because this difference in these three sounds, sa, e, ta, we can hear clearly a word, sit. So we can say that these sounds, they are different sounds. They are not same sounds. So sa is a phoneme, e is a phoneme, ta is a phoneme. So they occur in contrast with other sounds, and when there is a contrast, then it is meaningful. Now I will give you one example that all of us names are different, and our name is our identity, because once we meet someone, then the person raises a question, what's your name, or tell me about yourself, or introduce yourself. What is the first thing we say? My name is Amitabh, my name is Rahul, my name is Sarita. So these type of replies we give. So this is like we stand in contrast with each other, name wise. That means what is my name is not your name. So you can think of a situation when the name of all people is same. It's very confusing that who is whom. So this is same with the sounds, because these sounds, they are in contrast with other sounds, and that's why we can perceive them very clearly, and we recognize each word distinctively. Now second word is sip. Again three sounds, sa, e, pa, and again these three sounds in this word, they occur in contrast with other sounds. But when we compare what is the difference between these two words, sit and sip, we find that there is only one difference. And what is that difference? T and P. In first word we have T sound, and in second word we have P sound. And because of this one tiny difference, very little difference, the meaning is different. So what is sit is not what is sip, and what is sip is not what is sit. So this is the understanding of the definition of phoneme, that the minimal meaningful sound unit of a language which occurs in contrast with other sounds in a language. So now you know the understanding of this definition, that what does it mean. So in a word, different sounds, they occur in contrast with each other, and when we compare two words, then we also find that there is some contrast. So here the last sound is different, but if someone raises the question, what is the difference between T and P, then we know that though both the sounds are voiceless, we know that both the sounds are stop, but P is bilabial and T is alveolar. And what happens in bilabial? We know that two lips, they touch each other. And what happens in alveolar sound? The tip of the tongue touches the alveolar ridge. So this difference we can now very clearly, very distinctively we can make. So now we proceed further. Two sounds are phonologically distinct only if substituting one for the other changes the meaning of a sequence. So now it's like further extension that there are two sounds, let's say T and P in the word sit and sip. And these two sounds are phonologically distinct. So what is the meaning of something that is phonologically distinct? Only if substituting one for the other changes the meaning. So we know that if we have a word sit, and if we change the last sound T with P, then the meaning is different and we have a different word. So this is again an understanding that when only meaning is changing, when you change a sound, then you can say that those two sounds are phonologically distinct sound, phonologically different sound. Now we have another word, another example, like beam and beat. Now these two words are there, and when it comes to sounds, then you can see that in the word beam we have three sounds, ba, e, ma. So this is a long e, and we have previously discussed that two dots, they are also known as diacritics, and they are for lengthening. So we have a short e like e, e. So this is an example of long e, e. So beam and beat. When you look at the word level, you find okay, two letters are different, M and T. But here we are concerned about not the letters, but we are concerned about the sound. And we know that letter M corresponds sound M, and letter T corresponds sound T. So this is again the same example. Two sounds are phonologically distinct, and if we change them with each other, then the meaning is changed. There is one example from Hindi as well. For example, if the sentence is Ram jata hai, fine, and there is a sentence that ladke jate hain. Now you can very well sense the difference between these two. One is hai and another one is hain. So hain is nasalized, and you know what happens when something is nasalized. Something is nasalized, then the air also flows from your nasal cavity. So hai and hain, they are different. But what is the difference in the script? Hindi is written in Devanagari script. So I hope that most of you can read Devanagari script. It's written here. The difference is only of one dot. Otherwise, everything is same. And what is this dot represents? This dot in Devanagari represents the nasalization. That nasal cavity is also involved. And the meaning of the word is also different because of this. Hai is and hai is R. So one is auxiliary and one is R auxiliary. One is singular, another one is plural. Now in the transcription, you will find that both are same. Actually, both are not same because this is a vowel sound, a, fine. And you need to put a tilde like this type of, because somehow I was not able to do that using my computer system, but there is a tilde means like this type of mark. And if you make this type of mark on a sound, so you have her sound and a hain, so then it will become hain. So this is a transcription. So with the help of these symbols, you can transcribe any language. So you can consider IPA, International Phonetic Alphabet, as a universal script, irrespective of the fact whether the language is English, irrespective of the fact whether language is French, Korean, Hindi, Dogri, you can transcribe any language using IPA. So this is one benefit of IPA. For example, if I do some research here in India, and I want that someone who is reading in Germany can understand my work. So German, they don't understand English, because in Germany, most of the people, they know German only. But someone who is who knows certain linguistics, then the person can very easily read what's there in Hindi, as well as the person can understand it if he or she has some knowledge of linguistics. So now why I have taken this Hindi example, this is again a matter of concern. So I have written one thing, that oral vowels and nasal vowels are non-contrastive in English. Fine. So oral vowels and nasal vowels are non-contrastive in English. So you have one example like ma and ta. So that means even if I nasalize something, it is not changing the meaning. If I nasalize something in English, then, for example, in place of saying beat, and if I say beat, beat, that means if I make it nasalize, the meaning will remain beat. Even if I say seat, seat, sit, sit, or sip, I'm nasalizing E, sip, fine. Then sip will remain sip. It is not the case like now sip is something different. So this is the thing that oral vowels and nasal vowels are non-contrastive in English, and oral vowels and nasal vowels are contrastive in Hindi. So when you put a dot like this, he and ha, meaning is changed. So this information is also important because you can also check in your mother tongue whether this thing is contrastive or not. Another terminology that we will introduce today, that is minimal pair and allophone. These two terminologies we will discuss. So we can find out whether two different sounds are phonemes or only allophones by looking for minimal pairs. Minimal pairs, the definition of minimal pair, like once you have a word and when you transcribe a particular word, for example, sit and sip, so you find everything is similar, only there is a difference in one single sound. So in sit, you have the sound, and in sip, you have the sound. There is only one sound difference. So when there is only one sound difference, and because of that difference, the meaning of the word is changed, then it is known as a minimal pair. Pair means, you already know, pair means two things, and minimal means, again, we are talking about one individual sound unit. So minimal pairs are sound strings that differ by just a single sound but have different meaning. So if I say, what is the difference between sit and sip? If you do not have a knowledge of phonetics or in phonology, then you will say, in sit, we have letter T, and in sip, we have letter P. This information you can give me if you do not know phonetics and phonology. But when you know phonetics and phonology, then what information you will give? You will say, in sit, we have the sound, and in sip, we have per sound. That means these two sounds, they are in minimal pair. And because of these two sounds, the meaning is changed. That is to say, if I change the sound with per sound, meaning is changed. If I change per sound with the sound, meaning is changed. So that means these two are in minimal pairs. In English, you will find various words which are in minimal pair. So this is the definition of minimal pair, and if a sound occurs in a minimal pair, that means it is a phoneme. That means pa is a phoneme and ta is also a phoneme. So phonemes, they can occur in minimal pair. This is one thing. And allophone. Allophone is variant of a same phoneme, is known as allophone. Previously, I gave you example of clear la and dark la. Now, clear la comes word initially. When you say lake, 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 fine, lake, it's very clear la. But if I say fill, 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 ooh, ooh, it is dark la. So la, when it occurs word initially, it is clear la, lake, like, fine. I'm just emphasizing la sound so that you can make a difference between clear la and dark la. And if you have word like chill, 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 it's not clear. Oh, chill, chill. So when la occurs, finally, it is dark la. La sounds occurs word initially, it is clear la. Now, it's not the case that because of dark la and clear la, there is a change in meaning. That means they are variant of the same phoneme. L, 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 l. They are variants. That means la can be clear, la can be dark as well. So it's not only with the clear la and dark la, but you have aspiration as well. For example, if I say pill, P-I-L-L, pill, you know what I have said, pill. But as I said, like a native speaker will always say pill, pill. Native speaker will not say pill. We can say clearly pill because we know that in our language, pa is a phoneme and pa is a different phoneme. For example, in Hindi language or in other languages, like if I say pal, then you know pal means moment. Fine. You have a song like pal, pal, dil ke paas, fine. So it's from an old movie, you have this pal, pal, that means you know moment. But you have phal, pal and phal. So pa is a different phoneme, phal is a different phoneme. And what is phal? You know, fruit. So because of that reason, we do not have any problem in saying pill. But native speaker will always say, if pa occurs word initially, phil. Will not say pill, but always say phil. Fine. So this is that means you have two types of pa. But if I say pill or if I say phil, meaning will remain same. So when meaning remains same, then they are allophones and they are not phonemes. But in Hindi, meaning changes. If I say pal and if I say phal, so there they are phoneme. In Hindi language, pa and pa, they are phoneme. But in English language, pa and pa, they are allophones of the same phoneme. That means variant of a same phoneme. So similarly, you have like dagger. When you say dagger, then you are not pronouncing this g like this, but you are pronouncing g differently. Dagger, g, g, different g you are pronouncing. Again, you have beam and beam and beat. Now, one way, if I say beam and if I say beam, beam and beam. So that means like I'm not lengthening it that much. I'm not saying beam. I'm saying beam. And you understand, okay, I'm talking about beam. I'm not saying beat. I'm saying beat. So even if I do not lengthen it that much, but again, meaning is not changed. So that means you can say that English vowels of all types are automatically lengthened in front of voice obstruent. So what are obstruent sound? For example, stops, fricative, and affricates like d, fine, voiced. So now what is like when I say beat and when I say bead? So when I say bead, then automatically I am lengthening it. Why? Because d sound is voiced sound. D sound is voiced sound and d sound is also obstruent. What are obstruents? Obstruent is one class. So in obstruent, you can fill, you can put stops, fricative and affricate. But here we are concerned about voiced obstruent. We are not concerned about other obstruent. Otherwise, t is also an obstruent, but t is voiceless obstruent. So we have a different category of voiced and voiceless. So my suggestion to all of you that you must learn the three term labels for each sound. Because once you have these three terms labels of each sound in your mind, then things will be easier for you to understand that what we are discussing. So I stop here, and if you have any doubt or question, you can raise. And certain students, they try to enter.